start near the 100 and housing, and at the end we could have on the same area 120 housing. That means that we only are the latest project. So, after this famous conclusion, Anne and Jean-Philippe spoke about example of building, architecture, give you the goal of what we think with a simple attitude, which I summed up with
the
fact the constant research of more square, more light, more facilities, more pleasure to live. So we speak about that in one dimension. The name is architecture. We need, for sure, every town in every occidental country. You need, I think, in New York too, in Paris, in Bordeaux, in Shanghai. We need place for housing. Housing are the key of the city. Without housing, there is no city. So, with the intuition we have in Tourbeau-le-Prêtre, in Bordeaux, in Saint-Nazaire, we say, okay, why this could be it could be interesting to have a research about not the simple building, but consider all the city, case by case, in the same with the same attitude we have for an apartment or a building. So, because everybody search, every mayor has a double discussion. They say in the same time. We want that we conserve the mixity of the population in the city. We want to have the possibility to give low rent to every people in the city. But in the same time, they don't reject that. They make the promotion of the area, and all the price of the rent or the cost of the construction goes high. So, how to improve living conditions, how to improve the quality of existing housing, how and where to build new housing, how to significantly reduce energy consumption, how to allow financially as many people as possible access housing, how to conserve and increase the diversity of urban situation, how to increase urban facilities, how to update the livability of the city. How to finance the updating city, how to finance the generous transformation of existing housing building and the creation of new housing. So, we take the example of Tourbeau-le-Prêtre. I explained you before. The project we do is just transformation. We increase each situation. We give the best place for people. We give light, we give that. But in fact, if we prolonge, or you can understand by yourself. Maybe I can go. Now, if we prolonge the system of that, this is just a simple area in Paris. And we find the possibility to increase more without demolition, without cutting trees, we are modifying the road we can find on the same area, which is connected, not 100 housing, but 120 housing. That means that if we take care of each situation in the city, case by case, and we study 1,648 existing situations, including near 435,000 existing dwellings, to find the possibility to build on this area without demolition, without modification with, concerning all the quality of the existing thing, but with addition of a new building, we find the possibility to build 135,000 dwellings more. That means that we don't move the question of the plan of the city, we don't move the organization of the street, we don't move nothing. We don't need urbanism for that. It's for this reason that the problem I see is of the profession now, there's two professions, there is architect and urbanist. Architect who work with the foot on the floor, urbanist who work from the moon, design something and say to the architect, okay, you can put 41 housing here, 42 here, 100 here.
The campus.
If we mixed architecture and urbanism, for example, archivalism, urbanism, you have the choice to your problem. And if you take care very precisely, which people a lot of precision, it could be the same for the urbanism. If we take care with the precision of each case and say, okay, in this case you can find one housing more, maybe 20 or 100, and you can reorganize the city very kindly, very with a lot of generosity, and make in the same time housing, existing housing like project in Tourcoing, Prat or Saint-Nazaire or Bordeaux, and in the same time increase the city. The city is just density and diversity. If you work and demolish, you lost the diversity and you lost the density. So we study very, maybe stupidly, maybe with a grand naivete, all this situation, case by case. It's a long work. We work since 6 years. We pay for that. Nobody wants, everybody finds that very fantastic, but they don't pay for that. But for us, it's interesting to change the mentality of the urbanism, and we do that very precisely. We make fish for each case. We try to be more precise. We know exactly who are the owner, how many dwellings we have, how the construction, many things like that. It's very, it's not 140, it's 160. We consider for each study, we consider the rules, administrative and urbanistic rules and subjective rules. Subjective rules is to consider that we have people on the site. Maybe it's not very often we have trees, we have organization, and this kind of subjective topic are very important for us too. And after that, we make fish. And we find the possibility to find 1, 2, 10, 100 more. And at the addition of all these cases at the end, proves that we can find 135,000 building more. No more. That means we can change for, that this case is for Paris, but we make a job near like that in Bordeaux. And everywhere we can do that. You can take the foot on the floor, you can say, okay, we have that, we can increase that, we have to consider that, we have to pay attention for this people, and do that. No more. And we change. We have this one, you know. And the urbanism will be like that. It's not necessary to demolish. We have, I prefer the, I like the world is not transformation, is actualization. We have to actualize, for instance, the city, the world, the life, for the pleasure of everybody. Everybody, every building can be transformed. Every building, every building, every plot can be debriefed. A sustainable and quality intensification for the benefit of living. living space, usage, and inhabitants. Thanks a lot.
Especially the way in which you show the before and after pictures and the incredible transformation that happened with each one of these buildings, each one of these communities, and for each one of these individuals. It's quite remarkable. One of the questions that comes up for me, I think, Frederick, you finished up on this issue quite nicely, is the question of scale. And you talk about the scale of the dwelling, the scale of the building, the scale of the community, and even the city. Does the idea of dwelling, the idea of housing, change for you as the scale changes, or is it the same all the way through?
I think it's the same. I think the same. It's what's important. It is to consider each flat. Each family, each inhabitant, and then to consider it 10 times if it is a small building, 100 times, but with the same precision for one that we complete for all of them. Mm. So the scale is not so important. It is, if we go inside, we lose the essence of scale. If we go in each flat, we lose the idea of scale. Because precisely we are in the scale, the dimension of the family, of the inside of the space. And we see all the energy, the pleasure that this family has taken to improve its inside space. And if we see that, we cannot say this can be one house or it could be a building of 500 flats. This quality, we find it in any case. So starting from this richness, that very often nobody wants to see, we can go further. And it is incredible to see the pleasure of the inhabitants already when they leave their space, but also as soon as this space is improved, extended, immediately you have also new relationships between the neighbors that happen. So I think it's a very precise, delicate work, very precise dimension of the building. For us, isn't really,
if we consider that the city or any big scale is an addition of fragments of pieces of life or working, or this is the same people from the flat to the street, to the shop, to the park, to the museum. So it's endless continuity. So it's why we like to see from inside out, because it starts always from the scale of what we have around us.
One of the things that was very notable, especially in Trois Beaux-le-Prince, the original design by the architect Lopez, their loggia, their rivet windows, it's very horizontal. But then when the building was renovated, it felt like the building got closed. The windows were made smaller. The people who lived there were pulled back. And it felt, in your preservation or reuse or adapted or restoration. It really is a transformation. In your transformation, to my eye, it felt like part of that process was bringing the residents back forward. So they were, you were re-engaging them with the city so they could see the city again and the city could see them again. Is that notion of visibility part of that process for you, that transformation?
Well, for example, the example of Tourbonne Open in 95, the first renovation, you speak clearly about that. And then, you mean that, in fact, the inhabitants lost a lot, in fact. And the reason why they lost, it's because you have, in France, I think it's the same everywhere, lobby who speak about energy and say, okay, for the energy, we need to be enclosed, closed, we need a little windows. It was in 1995. 80, between 80 and 90. But it's the same now. About the question of energy, it's the same. In French, we say, okay, for the energy, we need a lot of insulation. We need we don't speak about people. We don't speak about how to live. We don't speak about housing. We speak about energy. And for sure, if you say, we need just energy and it's cold, you do that. Like that, it's not an answer to live. Yeah. It's a reason. And what is very fantastic with these two guys is we find the answer of that, but I never live in 20 centimeters of insulation, maybe some that, I don't know, but it's more interesting to live in two or three square meters large of balcony and winter garden. And we give the same answer, but with different recognition of the lobby of the construction at all. And it's evident we need to have to go outside to give more fluidity, to live, just to live. It's simple. Mm. It's a very simple idea, but
this is the idea of villa. Villa, Voyant, or villa, for example, we very often we take the example of the case to the housing as a social program for housing reference. And today it is interesting to consider this villa not only outside the city, in the countryside, but also inside the city on plenty of levels. But with the same quality, villa, it means that you have the freedom to turn around your flat. And this is very important also to develop inside the city. So inside the city, you live at the 8th floor or 10th floor or 15th floor, you can go, you can take the corridor, go in your bedroom, go out of your bedroom, go into winter garden, turn all along the facade, come back through the kitchen or the living room. You can keep turning on system. In the winter garden, you can have some gardening, some little, you can have some seats, you can. So it is this idea to live, to have a better relationship with the climate. And precisely with all these systems, it's kind of very simple tools like the panel of a winter garden, a solar curtain, the sliding windows of the that really make the separations inside and outside that can slide with another curtain. All of this, the owner, the inhabitant, he can use these tools very, very simply, just in function of its pleasure, its comfort. And by the way, it's producing its own energy saving itself. This is why we really believe that housing, the envelope, is really like a cloth that you have on your shoulders. It is never the same in the day, in the night, in the winter, or in the summer. But it is the possibility of choice of the inhabitants. Some inhabitants, they want to totally open because the sun is fantastic. Some others, they prefer to filter. Some others, they prefer to be in the dark. So to give all these possibilities of the inhabitants, and then they will choose what they want, function of them.
about the openness and the visibility. For us, it's maximum openness. There's no principle of frame, but for the ceiling, because the view is free. And for us, it's also related to an important concept that we have when we are designing projects. It's about escape. Escape means that as far as you see, it's part of your space. So it's also a way to expand your space of living, to expand. So for us, it's something nearly obsessionally strong.
I was struck by how many of the photos of the interiors of the different apartments, you could see the horizon from the living room, not just from the balcony, but from the kitchen. And I think that really emphasizes that point, how important being able to look beyond your space was in your designs. One of the other things that I found particularly inspiring about the way you talk about your work, here in the United States, when we talk about sustainability, I joke it's like talking about vegetables. You have to eat your vegetables. You have to make your building sustainable. But yet when you talk about sustainability, you talk about playing with climate. You talk about the importance of connecting pleasure to sustainability. Can you talk a little bit more about that idea? Because I think that's such a good thing for us to hear, so that we can really approach sustainability in a playful way, in a pleasurable way.
I think it's in the introduction you were talking about with ego. I think it's there is one question that is absolutely necessary. We cannot only make a flat as the addition of two bedrooms, one kitchen, one bathroom, one living room. To create a place for inhabiting, you need to give a sort of place of undetermination, places that the architect cannot say this is a winter garden. No, perhaps it will become a place with a canapé and sofa, or it will become a sort of a tropical garden, or it will become a place for the cat and the dog that are there. But in fact, this is absolutely important. And these qualities, they are so important that at the end, they make the fact of the sustainability. It is because of this pleasure that the people will love their flats, love their spaces, and because of that, it will become sustainable. Yeah. And if you add the question of passive energy, solar energy, etc., the consumption, etc., then the building and the flat, it will last many times because it's a place of pleasure. And you will always take care of the place where you find pleasure. We really believe in that. It's why we like to go back to the places where we have made some projects, to see what the people have done. We are always surprised. It is never the same. It is never the same. Each time we see some incredible inventions by people. So this possibility of more space, more possibility of choice, it is a possibility also for these people for invention. Because they invent, I was talking about little collections of objects, etc. Some others start to make painting or sculpture. So it is, the space has to allow this possibility. It's very important. And I think it is for us the most important condition for sustainability.
Sustainability is the concept of sustainability is to spend less material, less energy, less carbon, less everything. So and it's key that it's we don't believe in doing that with technology, but much more in the way how we do things very simply, and also. We think also that the responsibility of inhabitants of us is extremely important. So you can isolate as much as you want, If you open windows, you lose the... So it means that everyone must understand how it works to manage himself or herself also the savings. And it's important for if you want that people become responsible, you must give something generous. You can expect that people think to sustainability or to save energy if we continue to reduce more and more the size of the dwellings. Mm-hmm. And so it means that you must give something in exchange. So in the winter gardens, in the more space, the people understand very well how it works with the sun. When the sun becomes warm, and then they close the curtains. And in the night, in the winter, they close everything because they understand that the buffer zone is a kind of insulation. So, but all of this can happen if people are more relaxed with their conditions of living. If they are not compressed in their home, in the family, or if you give this generosity, you can expect more responsibility, and we need this responsibility to achieve a good sustainability.
We need to believe in people first, first, and we give just capacity, and they do so.
What I think it's a fantastic statement, and I'd like to go back to one of the comments that you made with regard to ego, and this concept that I put forward before we had a chance to sit here about humility, and there is a sense of humility as an architect, as a designer, in your work, in that you're willing to embrace somebody else's building and work on that building, and that your willingness to allow users to program the space, to decide how they want to use the space, which is, I would argue, very uncharacteristic of your typical architect who wants to make their own building, who wants to decide exactly what happens in every square inch. Can you talk a little bit more about that what I would read as humility in the way you approach design?
I think fundamentally, humility. Architecture is to raise for living. So it's why I was talking at the introduction about the void. Mm. We are not doing matter, we are working and trying to organize some voids in which life takes place. And I think this point is extremely important. So it means that the architecture only exists because of the life. So it's the life that when it comes that creates the architecture. So it gives some capacities, as Frederick was saying, but then the life of the inhabitant comes and then the architecture happens. Because architecture is not a sculpture. It is architecture, it is something in which we are inside, we live inside, we use it, we invite people. So it's a life that makes the architecture. It could be a housing, it could be a school, it could be a university, it is always the same, or it could be an art center. It is because of the life, because of the use, that architecture suddenly happens. The use can change, the inhabitants can change, the life will be different, perhaps some new functions will happen. But each time there is this reaction of the fact of inhabiting. And this reveals architecture.
Olkas and Andrea Ruby wrote a fantastic essay about some of your work, and in it they pointed out that you seem to embrace modernism from a formal standpoint, but simultaneously you contradict a lot of assumptions that modernism had, at least in its early iterations in the 1950s. I would argue, or they would argue, that you reject the tabula rasa of you reject the existence of in-law. Can you talk about that relationship between your work and how it fits in with the larger modernist, I guess, over?
I think we have to consider all this history of architecture at the moment where it was produced, at the time it was produced, and we have to consider it now, for the moment of the society today. So, and then we have to be extremely precise. In the modernism, like, for example, the DOT that saved the ground, and we can, the nature can go under. I like the transparency, I like the brown limb, I like the toit terrace, the roof terrace on which we can go. These, all these elements are, for me, they are very interesting, and they are very different with the more ancient architecture. So they are very interesting points of the modernism that we really like to develop in our project. But when the modernism comes and makes a sort of tabula rasa, takes away the old parts of the city, I don't understand that, and I prefer to be related with even some project of Fiona Friedman or Aki Graham that was working on the superposition of the city to the existing city. So we have to be very, very careful with all these points. It is not, we cannot reject definitively something. We have to perhaps to take precisely some points and to reject some of those and to establish what today, because also the conditions have totally changed, makes sense.
In general, for us, it's we don't like to think to a system should be replaced by another one. So we like, in a way, to have no selection in the history, and to take everything, but just take what we think is the best, and make with all of that. It's the principle of making do. It doesn't mean that we accept everything, but we accept the history as a whole. And the modernism is our history. It's our contemporary time. So for us, we don't see why it should be killed. To replace it by what? By something else? Is it better? Is it worse? So why finally it's so motivating, so inspiring to take things and to analyze, to criticize, to analyze, and to take what is good and to continue with that and to make it own for today.
I'd like to go back to your concept of combining the foot on the ground and the head in the moon. The urban texture or the archaism is, I'm not sure if I'm doing those justice. But what do you see as the relationship between some of your buildings and the city around them? I think it's absolutely fascinating. You took this concept of the dwelling to the building to the city. But there are also, as many of your images show, a relationship between the building and the city that's right around it. I think one of the more profound images was the way in which the neighborhood in Bordeaux seems to have been transformed just through those three buildings. Can you talk a little bit about that relationship between your architecture and the city around?
I think I don't remember exactly what you say. Jean-Philippe is perfect. He speaks about the city. Maybe it could be, I don't remember, he can repeat that. The city is a dwelling, and a dwelling is a city. Something like that. There is no limit. When I speak about the question of the view, when you are on the balcony, your apartment, the dimension of your apartment is not the number of square meters you have inside, it's all perspective you have in front of you. So you can see that from inside your apartment, and if you are in the city, you can see in the opposite. You can see, for example, the difference between when you are in the city in Bordeaux, the difference of the point of view of the old building and new building. It's a totally different. That means that architecture capacity you give for each people is by case for apartment or an apartment. It's an answer also for the people who live in the city. It's a benefit for the two. It's for a benefit for everybody. So there is no limit between architecture and cities for this reason. Because you have your apartment, you have staircase, you go in the hall, you go outside. Where is the limit? There is no limit. That means the city is inside the apartment, and the apartment is inside the city too. So it's for this reason we don't need our urbanist.
No, but I think it's a very big change. No. There is a big change, which is the fact that it is clear that we have to work today with the existing city. If we talk about sustainability, if we talk about ecology, it means that we have to consider what is already existing and stop consuming. It is important to see that even if we have a building that it is not good, if you add something to this building that is not good, it becomes better than
exactly.
Because precisely you just there is one part, something was missing, and you add just what was missing, but the rest was good. So instead of, it's like in France, this policy of demolition, it means that you have one, like one building or 100,000 buildings. One, you demolish, you take one down, and then you rebuild one. At the end of one, if you have one and you add 50% of one, at the end you have 150%. So it means less consumption, less money, and at the end you have more than what is done by the standard. So it is at this point that the efficiency of the transformation, it is to eventually keep something that is not perfect, but by adding something new to these things, you produce something new that becomes much more interesting than all the standards are doing actually. It's why in Bordeaux we have four social housing. We have built the most beautiful flats that we have in Bordeaux in this situation. By the efficient, with the transformation of the existing. And this is very important to take. So you have a multitude of places where this process of transformation is possible. And it is only possible if we think about starting from each precise point. The precision is the key point.
What we criticize is today, and we don't know the situation there, but in Europe it's something like that. Is there with the too big separation between urban planning and architecture? And most often, as architect, we have the feeling that the architecture is there to shape the city, to according to rules of heights, or and for us, it's we would like to see things in the other way around. So it means that we think that, and we expect in starting from the inside, that the inside and the way we start improving from the smallest will influence, we continue around, around, and around, and much larger. The problem is that most often, and then for all the projects that we show, the three projects of transformation, if we show you the original projects, you will see that we don't stop at the building. We propose always that, for example, the basis, the plinth, to create plinths that densify the ground and make a better connection at the scale of the ground, of the 2-3 levels. So, and all of this project did that. But at the end, after the competition, we are asked not to do that. We are asked to stop in the footprint of our building because this task of expanding buildings is given to the urban planners. So for us, it's something which is today that should be changed to create those better relations, especially because we are working on the existing cities and not from the for the plaza.
And it's not just also a question of architecture; it's a question of social point of view, because we don't make architecture for architecture. We make architecture for people who are inside. That all the demolition is not only demolition of a building, it's also the demolition of the life of people. So where go these people?
History.
Where they go?
Homeless shelter. Homeless shelter.
Yeah.
If you kick them out.
Yeah. The Auslandish.
Voilà. Vous avez raison. Voilà. Yeah. Vous venez ici. Hein. Yeah, c'est une option aussi. Vous venez ici. Non?
Yes.
It's I think it's simply about kindness. In the architecture of urbanism, they have to question themselves about this idea of kindness today, or do we consider the city, consider the inhabitants, and all starts with this, so we can be architect, we can be urban planner. I think the point is that each time we have to be what is necessary kindness at the starting point. So we think that when we are too far away from the situations, when we are not in the precise details that are precisely the questions that considering each inhabitant or each situation, when we are a bit too far, we cannot grant this kindness. We cannot find it immediately. So it's why the precision, the observation, listening, taking time is so important.
In looking at a lot of your work and being introduced to your work over 10 years ago, I kept asking myself the question, is it about education? Is it about dissent? Is it about activism? And the answer I kept coming back to was what you just said, was no, it's about kindness. And that's the shift. That's what requires us to change the way that we're thinking about so many of these problems, is because you're coming up with new solutions that start with kindness.
It's kindness also because we see today that the citizens, they are more and more involved in the city. They are more and more questioning the city, why this is imposed, why I cannot be questioned about what could be possible or not. This question of actually, we have to consider that all the citizens, they are really, really interested by what happens in their neighborhood, and more, and their right to think that. So, how we can work with them, help them. And it is, Frederick was explaining that, I don't know, probably in New York, it is like in Paris, so it means that we are in our office of architects, we are opening some reviews in which we are looking for competitions, but in all these competitions, there are already the urban plan has been done, the programmation has been done, the plot has been defined, and there are some rules, and as architect, we have to place our cake in the middle of the plot.
Wood.
And so nobody asked us to invent anything, just perhaps a form, but not so. When I work with my students in my school as professor, the results of the students by themselves, because they are concerned by the society, by the needs of the inhabitants, immediately when they are free, they do much more than the simple task that is given most of the time to architects. So I think it's a big waste of the talent of the architect. They probably at school, since they learn about listening, observing, taking time, being close to situations, and all this energy and is a waste in the professional life, unfortunately. Mm. So we have to change that.
Yes, we do. So we're going to open the floor to some questions. I believe we have a microphone here. If folks have a question and they would like to step up to the microphone.
Hi, 20 years of the San Radetzky lecture and talking about housing without people. I probably may have attended 30 years of Architecture League, again, housing without people, 60 years of United Nations Habitat, and housing without people. I'm happy we are here at Cooper Union, Union meaning architecture, art, engineering together. COVID-19 has revealed something amazing, which is housing without people. And this is at the core of, you know, if we are saying build back better. Vacancy, you know, whether that's retail, whether that's storefront, whether that's offices, workplaces, and housing. So before COVID, it was twice the buildings, housing without people, twice. Now, after COVID, if you look at buildings, the mix of buildings, whether those are housing or offices, workplaces, 3.5 times. So, my question to the panel and the person who is at the center, whom we don't know who is, and we would like to hear from him.
I was saying.
The question is at the core of the building and the core of the architecture, which is the toilets and the tenure. You know, when we are looking at building, I think to fix buildings, to make them work, to, you know, and you know, people within, I think, you know, the technology, the engineering, the toilets and the tenure is at the core. So the person at the center, I would like to address that. Thank you so much, and thanks the AIA Housing Committee. You know, I am so glad. Thank you so much.
Well, I appreciate to be given a voice. I'm here really just to help make sure that the questions are understood.
As a translator, exactly.
It's called mental tools. About the people who don't have housing and perhaps people who also don't have a voice and how these wonderful architects that happen to be associated with are able to engage with that condition. So I think that I will, now that I've given them the idea, maybe we'll let you continue, please. But thank you for the opportunity. General about the question of, I believe the question, and perhaps you can make sure I've understood you correctly, about the large number of housing units that are vacant, that are not currently being used, and that that's actually increased as a result of the pandemic, and how we respond to that is, I think, of crucial importance, especially as you're also building extra housing. We have already excess housing that's empty, but often empty for the wrong reasons.
It's clear that I think it's everywhere in the world there is a crisis on the question of housing. We have made some workshops recently in Australia, in Sydney. So it's always the same question, always the same municipality asking for affordable housing, but in the same time, never making what is necessary for that. So it is just words and not real action, in fact. In order to consider affordability and the possibility to make good housing at affordable price. The question it is that the crisis of housing in Paris, we have not enough flats, and the quality of the space is very bad, but it's fine because the market goes higher. So it's the speculative system is quite happy with the situation of crisis.
Yes.
And you have not so many other fields in which it happens like that. Precisely, if you look at the increase of the rent or increase of the caused by experimental on the flats during these last 20 years, it has considerably increased, and the amount of the budget for housing in the budget of the
even
family
me,
has
nope.
totally increased, so it means that you have actually this problem is extremely complex. And we have really, as architects, tried to think how we can participate, try to change these questions.
I think that's the key. Sorry.
No, actually, it's a problem of speculation in the big cities, because for the owners, finally they earn enough just because they belong to the buildings, because the cost is always increasing, and they earn a lot of money without the problems of renting. So
that's
it's a really a strong political problem, but as architects, we of course we just observe it, but we have of course no impact on it. And for sure, it's a big problem because the cities are more and more empty. While there is a so big problem of housing,
okay.
But it's a problem of speculation, and housing should really be removed of any system of financialization. That would be the only solution.
That's the reason my question was actually for the core of the building, for the core of architecture, and not about the political, or not about this, what's happening between COP15 and Glasgow, that, you know, housing without people or buildings without people situation. My question is, you know, about toilets and tenure, because just like facade, the engineering of the facade and the opening of the buildings, same with the core of the building. You mentioned about elevators, but also the toilets and plumbing. That is something, you know, people, community, you know, a house, you know, interacts very closely, and very expensive, very technically challenging. So how do you deal with the core? You know, that's the.
So I think
the core is hardcore.
In the
you know,
I think we're going to get to a lot of you other questions.
I think it's the work of an architect to work efficiently on those questions of grounding or without taking the best part of the dwelling, the facade is there to bring a light or to bring access to outside. So it's yes, it's a skill of an architect to work efficiently and in a very good way on such issues.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. I think in building densities for residences as sort of this mass housing scheme, we've done an excellent job of providing sufficient light, sufficient air, and basically everything that's common sense, but expanded in such a way that the luxury is no longer luxury. My question is, between the scale of units or dwellings, and the scale of building, there are also opportunities of sharing spaces, community spaces, that happens outside of the generosity of the unit, but inside the building envelope, or slightly outside of it within the territory. You didn't emphasize that in your work, but I know there are some. So I want you to maybe speak about that. I come from China, a country that is massively in a it's not necessarily the housing crisis that the housing markets are sort of bouncing around, but the main question is how we live together, you know.
We believe really that a good situation for individual life is the best condition for the collective life.
Yes, we in giving more space for each individual, dwelling, we think that it's the first step for the community, because the community can start at a very small scale, the scale of your neighbors. So most of people who have many tiny apartments, they never invite anyone because it's quite impossible. So if you have more space, you can already invite invite the friends of your children, invite your neighbors, invite, and this is the beginning of the community life. And afterwards, it's clear that you can create additional communal space in the housing, in the two-world plan, or in the transformation we did, We reopened many spaces for the community, which has been closed over the time. But we see that it's very difficult because it's not only the fact to create them. How do they live afterwards? Who pay for it? Who is in charge of maintenance? Who organize the life inside? So it's always a good idea to do it, but you can observe if you not in all countries. For example, if you go to Switzerland, it works very well because they have this culture. But in most of countries, you can see that afterwards it doesn't work very well. So for us, we think that the communal space cannot be a kind of compensation of a too small individual space, and that if we cannot do the both, we prefer start by giving more to each, because it allows everyone to have this collective relation. So it's a very interesting question, but there is no one solution.
I think we have time for one more question. I think we're just going to have you back.
So that was it. I tried.
Yeah, sorry, time is running out, but we have, you know, a very large internet audience, and I just wanted to get at least one question from our internet audience. And, you know, the projects you present are so successful, and transformations seem so robust, that this individual asked the question, have other architects in France adopted your method of transformation of social housing?
I cannot say that there are so many. We know that many would like to do it, but they either they don't find the good situation, or they don't struggle enough to achieve it, because of course when we present it, it seems to be easy to be, but it's a long process of discussing, of keeping our conviction or making no compromise. And I think we think that any architect could do it with a will of doing it. Of course, you need to find the client, which also agrees to do the same. It's also very difficult because, for example, in France, there's a lot of social housing companies. Many of them they don't agree so much for demolition, and they would like to go towards transformation. But at the last moment, they don't take the decision, because to take this decision, it means that it asks a kind of courage for the not really for us, but for the owners to go towards that. But what we see in probably that today the situation has in a way changed with
the
ecological urgencies. With the COVID, which has shown how the housing is extremely important in the life, and probably it will change some minds, and we see also that in the schools where we are teaching, and the young students they have really this. This approach, and probably in the next year it will change.
Do you teach them Occupy Wall Street? That was exactly 10 years ago, sorry, to the day, Monday. Did that have any impact on you? Occupy Wall Street was exactly 10 years ago. Did that have any impact on your teaching? Madame, excusez-moi, mais je m'excuse, il y avait un mouvement pour la justice en Angleterre, on est ici en New York City, d'ailleurs, Occupy Wall Street. Est-ce que ça est entré? Est-ce que vous faites l'inclusion de ça ou non? Pas du tout. parce que moi, les archigrammes, ils ont des idées qui sont par vous. I am sorry for this, of course, madame, but thank you so much that at least on Monday, Occupy Wall Street.
Right, sorry. And honestly, can we have one final question? This fine fellow, and I promised him that he could come. So, one more question for the evening.
Yes, occupy space and time. No, Kant, metaphysics.
I'm sorry, that's a lot of pressure for me. Last question. Anyhow, I wanted to know, you pointed out some of the windows in the older units, and you said that they were plastic. And I was looking at these new windows, most of these buildings, full of windows. And I'm wondering how well they're going to take wear and tear. Are they durable? Are these buildings durable? I'm sure Truid Igo looks very good when it was first completed. How well will they take wear and tear and vandalism and maintenance issues, things like that?
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. Yes.
Anyway, thank you so much. A film by Rainer Garnau. You can buy it. Sorry, of course, Occupy Wall Street sponsor. Rainer Garnau, comme des marxistes. Look at this shit. Look at this shit. Sorry, I am naked here.
In the interest of precision and specificity, which has been a kind of theme through tonight, I want to say a couple of additional thank yous to Brian and to Peter Lafitas, who was taking the questions from the internet, who are the chairs of the AIA Housing Committee, and to Ben Prosky and Joseph Corbin from the AIA, to Nadia Tarani, Nora Kawi, and Mauricio Aguera from Cooper Union, and to Anne Wieselbach and Rocky Lane from the Architectural League. This has really been a terrific three-way collaboration. The work that Frederick and Anne and Jean-Philippe have done together is an inspiration and a provocation. Brian used the word humility in one of his questions, and for me, the signal quality of their work is their boldness as analysts and as designers, clear-eyed, careful, precise observers and creators with no sacred cows. And the combination of that fearlessness with deep humility and respect, first of all for the people who inhabit the buildings they create, along with respect for the material, environmental, social, and economic investments that our existing built world represents, and that must weigh heavily in the calculus of our present actions. They are fiduciaries in the very best sense of that word, of the interest of all of us and of the finite resources of the world that we share and depend on. The frugal toughness of their attitude towards the material world is paired with an expansive generosity of their imaginations and the respectful embrace of the capacity of all kinds of people to invent and arrange for themselves the specific conditions of their daily lives. Thank you for showing us the power of these pairings, of boldness and humility, of frugality and generosity, and of the radical possibilities for architecture that they create. Thank you so much.